Alright, so... Lucerne and back, that's not far. Evidently two here in Lucerne as well. We'll check out the, Do I hear a sound? Sometimes when I talk, I think a sound happens. Oh, Bayalt. We'll check out this while we're here, and then continue going around. Lucerne's heat pummels the Nirana belt, a ring of protoplanetary material relatively close to the star. However, this heat is not enough to instigate true melting as occurs in a planet's formation, so carbonaceous asteroids such as Bayalt retain a primitive makeup. Bayalt has yet to be exploited, so the Reapers appear to have ignored it. Probes suggest it is high in chondrites and troilite. I have to remember to scan that. Since Reapers haven't been there, there might be something that we could use. Alright, let's check out the planets here. Jontan. Jontan is a fairly standard close-orbiting Pegasid gas giant, orbiting the star Lucerne at high velocity and heated to temperatures of over 1,000 degrees. Analysis of its orbit has revealed a core of heavy elements with a mass double that of the planet's hydrogen-helium atmosphere. Untanta. Untanta is remarkably close to Earth. Its orbital distance is similar, and while slightly larger, its reduced density yields similar mass, atmospheric pressure, and gravity. There, the similarities end, for Lucerne is a hot class F star, emitting over 8 times the energy of Sol. Untanta is a parched wasteland, its water long since boiled away into its nitrogen carbon dioxide atmosphere. A handful of mining outposts dot the hellishly hot surface. The crews remain in underground bunkers, sending remotely controlled machines out at night to do surface work and load cargo for shipment. Population 230. Gravity identical to that of Earth. Day length almost identical to that of Earth, and as well as atmospheric pressure, yeah. They're right, it is very close, very similar to Earth. Goes around the sun much quicker, though. Third planet. Dorye. Dorye is a large hot world with a poisonous atmosphere of acidic nitrogen oxides. While the planet is too close to Lucerne for this to condense and fall as rain, this makes the environment too hostile for forms of life more sophisticated than bacteria to evolve. Fourth, Tarith. Tarith is broadly Earth-like with a fatal flaw, and has a relatively high amount of chlorine in its atmosphere, the reason for the greenish haze that becomes apparent when looking at the horizon. Chlorine has become a vital component in Tarith's plant life as a defense mechanism against native herbivores. Many species evolve the ability to release clouds of toxic chlorine when disturbed. This gas is heavier than the atmospheric oxygen and tends to settle in low places. While avoidable, this has placed Tarith near the bottom of the list for colonization. There are intermittent signals originating in the heart of a large chlorine swamp. They appear to be coded, though it is not impossible that they are garbled distress signals from a downed civilian ship. We have to scan for that. But first we'll check out the last planet. Zetik. A common methane ammonia gas giant. Zetik is best known for the infamous Kalthor camp. Established on the ice moon of Jesus, Kalthor was a Blue Sun's hostile environment training facility, run by a cadre of former Batarian Special Intervention Unit operators. In 2168, a cluster-wide scandal broke out when it was revealed that the mortality rate of recruits sent to the camp might be as high as 18%. Investigation by Asari authorities based on Ilium uncovered group graves around the facility containing the remains of several hundred recruits dating back two decades. The camp was immediately closed and the remains sent back to their worlds of origin. An inquest by the Blue Suns found the Batarian commandos had used harsh training methods, but these were consistent with their own training to join the SIU. The Batarians were exonerated, though Kalthor was shut down, and they were reassigned to other units. As the Crescent Nebula is beyond the sphere of Council law, no civil charges could be filed against the Blue Suns. What a shame. I'm sure they have enough charges against them already. Nothing at these two. That's pretty good. That's not bad at all, actually. There's gonna be two... here. One of which will probably be out here in space, not on a planet. Hope you'll come across her. This is a large system. Don't leave the system. Well, I want to scan that asteroid, remember? So I'm wondering what scanning systems, if we're going to be scanning systems and planets. I mean, in Mass Effect Andromeda, I know we scan planets, we've seen it. But I wonder what the mechanic is going to be like. And if you scan systems as well, into different clusters and such. It's going to be all different, obviously. Nothing familiar. Such a huge system. Keep going. I'm excited to be playing it. Kind of timed this well, the way Mass Effect 3 is going to end, like just a month or so before Andromeda comes out. Literally no wait for it. This is Bayalt, yeah. Pretty cool. And then I'll play the DLC as they come out and stuff. It'll be neato. I thought I reached the last... Nope, it's here. Damn, it's just a big system. You imagine there's nothing in... They're all on planets, could you imagine? It's possible. I'd just rather find it before Reapers go on mega alert, so I can scan the planets after. Quickly. So much empty space, I might have missed it. We'll try here. Damn it. Alright, let's scan that asteroid. And the gas giant at the same time.
Signal confirmed.
Got one. Credits recovered. Cool. They're like barely alerted here. Alright, let's go here. Thank you. Well, we can scan a bunch more, can't we? Where's all these planets? I can scan these two. This one, right? 4, 5. Compensating for how big the system is. Giving us more chances. Can't find it, damn it. All right, we're out. We got to find something on Lucerne, or in Lucerne, rather. Oh, I hate leaving it like that, too. I just don't know where it is. I scan so much. So I go back in and start... How many Reapers were there? Let's save. See if I can just scan with Wild Abandon along the bottom of the system. Oh my god, so fast! Go, go! Alright, move along the top. I stopped too. I hate that. Oh my god. It's so fast, the thing at the end. It builds up speed or something. Crap, I don't know if I have enough to get back to the mass relay.
Evasion successful.
I don't want to come in exactly where the Reaper is.
Reapers eluded.
Oh, damn it. Well, we're just going to find out where it is, right? And then I'll come back. I stopped. What? Look at it. It was like pushing me.
Reapers eluded.
So fast at the end.
Faster than light jump successful.
Okay, right by the sun. We haven't really focused on the innermost part of the system as much. I can't find it. This is insane.
Reapers eluded. Than light jump successful.
Try one more time, guys. Sorry about all this. You know, it might move every time you go into out of the system as well.
Evasion successful.
I have no idea. Alright, saving Lusarn for another time. That's a pain. Wish you could find it. So what's the last one? Crescent, Nebula, Minos, Wasteland. Where is Minos, Wasteland? If we don't find a lot of fuel here, to pop out of the system for a little bit. Oh, this is all, we don't even need fuel. This is all that there is. Okay. Let's check out the planets first. Oh, Fortis, right, with Veer, the planet Veer. Veer Koto. A pressure cooker planet with a thick nitrogen-heavy atmosphere, Veer is largely ignored by the galactic community. Poor Veer. Probes have revealed a crust of nickel and scorched carbon, both of which can be found in abundance elsewhere at far lesser temperatures. And how'd the little speech go? I want your head put on a pike as a message to the coming generation that some things come at too great a price. I want to look up into your lifeless eyes and wave like this. Can you and your associates arrange that for me, Mr. Gordon? I don't think the beginning was quite accurate, but close. Pietas. Though Pietas has a combination of features that make terraforming a possibility, the rights to the planet have been tied up in Citadel Council courts for the past 9 years. The running joke is that by the time the Council finally gives the go-ahead to colonize the planet, Pietas will have evolved life of its own. Home to comfortable temperatures and a mild atmosphere of mostly nitrogen and argon, Pietas could be habitable with the addition of oxygen-producing cyanobacteria. Its crust is high in silicates and carbon, allowing for easy fabrication of construction materials. Smugglers, pirates, and other unregistered starships sometimes touch down on Pietas to lay low or make repairs. Civilian travel is not advised. And finally, Equitas? I don't know. Home to the infamous Iron Canyons, Equitas has reddish iron oxide dust, hematite, covering much of its surface and significant blue cobalt deposits that freckle the terrain. Turian explorers have discovered hot springs in the polar ice caps, heated by magma in the planet's crust. In a strange combination of science and hucksterism, a small facility exports water from these springs, which is bottled and sold as having medicinal properties. The funds are then used to maintain a research station, which has discovered some fossil evidence that Equitas once harbored microscopic life based on deoxyribonucleic acid in these springs. Interesting. Okay. What can we find here? Small system, so it should be easier to find something. Nothing on this side of the sun. Oh, I hear it.
I found something.
They're very alert. I found 200 units of fuel. Cool. Oh, in here. Cool, both. Small enough that we're able to find both. Nice. Somewhere this way. Probe launched. Credits. Cool. We're done. The only thing is that one system, we just had to find in that Ismar Frontier. Crescent Nebula. There's one thing in that huge system we couldn't find. So annoying. Let's just run back here to Horsehead Nebula and fuel up. Then we'll check out our war assets. We'll just hang out here like we sometimes do. Probably no messages. Let's just check anyway. Nope.
Commander Shepard.
I sure am. Ugh, you know, I get stuck in that. They're back. Let's check in with Rex.
Need something, Shepard?
Where were these guys? Nothing new.
That's it for now, Rex. Let's get back to work.
Anytime.
Anything to say about our new Prothean member?
Yes, Commander.
Nothing, okay.
That's all.
Of course, Commander.
Disappointed. Maybe they would have said something before if they hadn't been glitched out at the time. I don't know. Then we got some new alien and alliance stuff going on that we found. Liquid assets. Yeah, what the hell is that all about? No war can be fought without a bankroll, and the corporate mavens of Ilium know it. Having escaped the invasion, a so-called Gang of Five is leveraging their staggering financial power to acquire the best talent and materials for the Prothean device. They are doing so in necessary ignorance, believing they are hiring and acquiring parts for a new kind of fusion plant, as the device's existence is a tightly guarded secret. An alliance. Got a few. Four of them. 103rd Marine Division, which is probably just an update. Not sure about this. Updated. Nicknamed the Bridge Burners, Team Zeta are combat engineers who specialize in destroying enemy fortifications in hostile territory. This tight-knit group of men and women are respected for their knowledge, renowned for their tenacity, and infamous for their enthusiasm. Biotic students from the Grissom Academy have joined the team. That we had, so. I guess this is the update. I think it'd be in order, though. Alliance First Fleet. We just found this, yes. The SSV Agincourt was one of the many Alliance ships that saved the colony world Elysium from pirates and slavers during the Skellion Blitz in 2167. In order to stay with his vessel and crew, its captain refused promotion after the Blitz. Updated thanks to Arius Hacker, the Cerberus files located in General Petrovsky's afterlife headquarters were retrieved mostly intact. I think we've read this, but what the hell. The encryption ciphers are complex, but Arya has her top technicians scraping the data for anything that may be of use to the Alliance. Key intel on Cerberus activities in Alliance theaters has already been found, providing the forces fighting in those areas a tactical edge. In more heavily encrypted files, valuable threads are emerging that could uncover top-secret Cerberus operations. Alliance Third Fleet. The SSV Nairobi is a top-of-the-line cruiser, with the showroom finish of a ship just off the factory line. As it has never seen warfare, the Nairobi's officers have been running mock battles in preparation for real enemy contact. And the Spec Ops Team Delta. This whole thing is new. Half of Team Delta's officers have an N5 designation, with a few N6 soldiers in the ranks. They specialize in conflicts outside Citadel space. Delta is known for strict admission standards, professionalism on high-stakes missions, and the Alliance's loudest parties. When asked how senior staff looks at their off-duty rowdiness, Captain Matthew Brown was quoted saying, "After the shit we went through in the Terminus systems, they're just happy we're not burning down the base." Funny. Okay. Done. And where am I going? Okay, so coming next episode will be the beginning of the Leviathan DLC.
Commander.
And after that, we'll be continuing going to Tachanka, doing the quests there, including the main quest. In, I guess, no particular order. I don't know. However we come across it. Thanks for watching. See you next time, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.